Welcome, everybody. My name is Masood Hussain, and I'm going to introduce our first inaugural seminar of the Dementia Research Oxford seminar series. This is a new grouping of people that we brought together in Oxford. And if you're interested in finding out more, please have a look at our new website, which brings together the research areas within Oxford, particularly on Alzheimer's disease, on cerebral vascular dementia, on Parkinson's dementia, and also on ALS and frontotemporal dementia. We're also highlighting here on the right all the assets that we have across the university in terms of the institutes that are involved in aspects of dementia and neurodegenerative conditions research. So this work pulls together three themes of activity from drug target to treatment, from molecular pathology to early detection and diagnosis, and also from early intervention to prevention. So it's bringing all this research together across Oxford, but perhaps most importantly, it's bringing together a whole host of people from a range of different specialties and expertise across the university. And we've put up a wall of people who involved here. If you're involved and we haven't put you up, we're sorry, please let us know, we'll put you on there. And if you think you should be involved, please also let Nick Irving know, and then we can put you up there. But our aim really is to bring together the expertise across Oxford and to do something substantial in the future on dementia research. And today is our inaugural speaker. I have Cornelia van Duyn, who is Professor of Epidemiology at the Nuffield Department of Population Health. Cornelia did her PhD in genetic epidemiology at the Erasmus University Medical Center in Rotterdam. And she was in Rotterdam for 30 years, where she performed some very important landmark studies. In 2016, she moved to Leiden. But we were lucky enough in Oxford in 2018 to steal her here. And she is currently based at the Big Data Institute. I've got to know her and appreciate her go-get-em personality and mindset as we've tried to put together Dementia Research Oxford. And I'm very glad she's kick-starting our seminar series. And today she's going to talk to us about bridging the gap between basic clinical and population dementia research. We'll have chat questions later on. You won't be able to put your hand up at the moment, but please put it questions in the chat, which we'll open later in her talk. So over to you, Cornelia.
Thank you, Masood. Do you see my slides now?
Yes.
I'll put them. You need not see my monkey background on the screensaver. So thanks for the kind introduction, Masood. So I thought, as I'm quite new in Oxford to perhaps a couple of you, or many of you, my background is genetics and epidemiology, both of them. The past 30 years, I've been trying to bridge the gap between genetics and epidemiology. But now in Oxford, I really have the mission to go for bridging the gap from discovery to translation. So that will be involving mostly multi-omics data. And that is also the topic that I want to talk about today. So we're supposed to be a very multidisciplinary group, so I will summarize briefly for you the background in genetics and epidemiology that are the basic to know for understanding this talk. And then we'll move to a talk that really targets the interplay between the genome, the metabolome, age, and dementia. And then move briefly on to some of the data that we've been analyzing now. Now, we're here in Oxford, but started already in Rotterdam based on an iPSC-based cellular model. So working on genomics of Alzheimer's disease, like many other diseases, we're finding more and more genes. And the pathways that have been emerging have been changing a little bit over time, but one of the major pathways emerging from the genetic research is lipid a lipid-orientated pathway. Lipid binding, cholesterol transport, as we know it, the reverse transport between LDL, HDL, and the liver. And of course, in addition to that, many of you know, I assume, are knowledgeable of Alzheimer's disease, the major pathways that we know in the pathology, amyloid beta aggregation, and tau pathology. So this has been a journey that I've been involved in since I started my career, because as an epidemiologist, I thought, well, we first have to solve the genetics. So I've been working a lot on apolipoprotein, but also APP mutations. And actually this year we have been also very active, and last year in Oxford, finding new genes. So we have now almost doubled the number of genes in a consortium called EADB, the European Alzheimer's Disease Database, GNPD funded, and that really is a major leap forward. So where do these genes point to? I think with all the interest nowadays, again, in amyloid as a pathway to therapy, actually more than ever, the new genes that we identified last year point again to amyloid. Now, what is to know about the epidemiology? Well, the epidemiology of dementia is summarized in the Lancet by a committee that has been reviewing this now at least twice. What are the major risk factors? And these are age. The more older you are, the higher your risk of dementia and apolipoprotein E. Further, there is, of course, sex, education, the usual suspects, alcohol and smoking and obesity. Physical activity popped up relatively new, and air pollution and loneliness are also relatively new kids on the block. As to comorbidity, there is quite some interest in cardiometabolic disorders, and that has been a field that we have been yielding major contribution to in my days in Rotterdam. We've been studying a lot the interplay between cardiometabolic, vascular risk factors and dementia that include diabetes, hypertension, but also stroke. So in some, the usual suspect from a vascular perspective. However, if you think about the cardiometabolic risk factors, there is really a complex relationship, because around a period between 10, maybe a little bit more years before the onset of the disease, people start changing their metabolism. So while patients with dementia are often obese around the age of 50 until the middle age, afterwards, they start losing weight and become actually having actually develop a lower weight than average in the population. So, what we also see in terms of metabolism is that there is a reduction of the availability of glucose in the brain, while there is higher levels of glucose in the circulation. And what we see that not only weight changes before the onset of the disease, but many patients also develop a low blood pressure as opposed to a high blood pressure before the onset of disease. So in the blood, we see different changes. We've been working a lot on that. Other people have as well, that you see in the blood, there's really large changes in a large series of lipids, but also amino acids and energy metabolism. So the changes in metabolism really came to light, I think, earliest already in the previous century. And it was first noted by Ingmar Skog and published in The Lancet already in 1996. And that was the astonishing reduction in blood pressure that you see in those who develop Alzheimer or over age, if you look at it cross-sectionally, but also longitudinally. So that is the least to say remarkable. And as we all realized, if you have the basic vascular knowledge, your blood pressure is closely intertwined with your BMI, your weight. And when I came to Oxford, one of the first things to read, I received from Val Barral, and that was a paper of Sarah Flood, was also part of our DRO community together with Jill Reeves, that really had the remarkable observation that if you consider BMI as a risk factor of dementia in the Million Women study, you found that those with a low BMI had an incredibly high risk of dementia up until 5 years of the before the disease risk. But if you look longer back, so took the period between the measurement of BMI and the onset of dementia and longer, you saw that this increased risk of lean people disappeared, and you rather see a very modest increased risk. So again, this points to this changes that we see in your weight of a patient in the window before the onset of disease. So how does this relate to what we see in animal studies? And that is one of the findings that have come in the past years, that there has been an increase in animal research of the findings that both the mitochondrial as well as the TCA cycle, the energy cycle producing ATP, play a crucial role in aging mouse. And that's of interest because all of us have been taught the TCA cycle as far as our first lessons in biology. And that is really major, the energy provider in the organism, just depending on different kind of fuel. So we all like to use as much as possible glucose as a direct fuel, but we can also burn in the TCA cycle fatty acids or amino acids, in particular branch chain amino acids, here abbreviated as BCA. So what is the relevance of all this for dementia and the changes in metabolomic features of dementia? Well, if you think about the TCA cycle, it's one of the mechanisms in which the liver can also make up for a situation that you have shortage of glucose in an organ, and particularly our vital organs like the heart and the brain and the kidney depend on that. In the case that you either are short of glucose or you are fasting or losing weight, the ketone-related diets are very popular nowadays. And what basically happens if there's not enough glucose around for these vital organs, ketone bodies, particularly beta-hydroxybutyrate, but also acetoacetate, are produced in the liver to provide these tissues with sufficient energy. So it's interesting, if you take the animal studies and the human clinical epidemiological observations together, you would start hypothesizing that there is a problem in the organism in maintaining its metabolism and energy, and therefore you see these reduction in weight. So the research question we ask NEPS is, are there signatures in the blood that can explain why you start to see these cardiometabolic changes? And of course, thinking of the TCA cycle is a suspect there. So the second question we ask is, how do these signatures then relate to the genetic and epidemiological risk factors? So this is the second part of my talk, and that is really at the heart of the observations. And this is a study we have conducted in the setting of Oxford in UK Biobank. And we're using the NMR metabolomics platform of Nightingales, which have characterized 125,000 persons. 50,000 of these persons that have been characterized by this platform are 60 years or over. There is about 1,188 dementia patients characterized in that. 553 and 209 are Alzheimer's disease patients, and 298 are vascular dementia. So a large number are unclassified, and we're still working with to classify those using the metabolites if possible. So this platform is really very well suitable for our aims. Look at energy metabolism, because among the 145 directly measured metabolites are a lot of fatty acids, a lot of cholesterol subfractions. The amino acids are covered, the branched-chain amino acids, as well as a series of TCA-related metabolites, including the ketone bodies. So how we set out to analyze these data is first zoom in on those 60-plus category, because there's very few patients who develop dementia before the age of 60. So we focused first on the 60-plus years and conducted a classical Cox proportional hazard model, aiming to associate all of these in metabolites individually to the risk of dementia. If you do that and adjust for age, sex, ethnicity, BMI as a major confounder, the fasting time of a person, patients who haven't been fasting in the UK Biobank, and some technical aspects of the spectrometer, we do see that an astonishing number of metabolites are associated to dementia, 151 out of 249, that's 61%. And of course, that's a bit too good to be true. So what we had already is some experience from our Rotterdam days in the Netherlands, analyzing this platform of Nightingales. And what we found before and published in Nature Medicine is that a lot of these metabolites are very much influenced by your medication use. So that gives us a hint, because many of the Alzheimer's patients and vascular dementia patients in particular are of course medicated because of their cardiometabolic pathology. And if you adjust for that, you find that about 56 out of the 249 metabolites are associated with dementia, that's 23%. And it goes down to 90% if you also adjust for pleiotropic effects of apolipoprotein E. So how does this look if you compare Alzheimer's disease and vascular dementia? So how we did that is that we associated what the associations that we find in dementia, all dementias, with those if we analyze specifically Alzheimer's disease, that's the left side picture. And we see that, that there clearly are signatures for Alzheimer's disease in there. The correlation between the two associations is about 0.69. And the p-value is really 10 to the minus ridiculous. It's very significant. We also see vascular dementia sickness in there, again, an R-squared is a little bit lower. You expect that. There are fewer patients with vascular dementia in all dementias, but the correlation for is still very high, 0.48, and again, very significant. If you then take only the Alzheimer patients and the vascular dementia patients, so the Alzheimer on the y-axis, the vascular dementia on the x-axis, you see that the correlation is not that strong. It is nominally significant, p-value is 0.01, and the R is 0.15, but there clearly is a less significant association between the two. Now, from this, we ask our next question, can we replicate the findings? And there we have been a lot of giving this some thought, but then we thought, well, we're analyzing now the risk of dementia only in the 60 plus, because we think the risk of dementia before 60 is almost negligible. So we have all these endophenotypes that are associated to dementia risk in the future in those who are 60 minus. And of course, what we can do is use these endophenotypes. So for instance, the volume of the hippocampus is a strong predictor of Alzheimer's disease. We can see whether we find an association also for the metabolites that we found associated to dementia. This is what is depicted in the first row. Do we see a similar effect in for the volume of the hippocampus, or the volume of the white matter hyperintensities as a measure of vascular pathology, usually we think the volume of the brain or the volume of the gray of the white matter. And lo and behold, we see the same metabolites are associated, and that more or less suggests that we can more or less replicate most of the findings if we look at these early pathology. Now, to attach a p-value on these patterns of associations, we gave them that some thought, and then we thought, well, we may as well do this, test how these patterns of associations are correlated. We may well do that using a random effect model that, on the one hand, adjusts for the fact that we have very much correlated observations in terms of the metabolites, which really are showing up as big clusters, right? So all the VLDLs, the very large cholesterol particles are very much correlated together, but they partly also correlate inversely to HDLs, because what these two guys do is exchange the cholesterol amongst each other in the blood, so they have to be correlated. So in order to correlate the findings in the 60 years and older and the 60 minus group with the metabolites, we really have to adjust for all these correlations that are seen between these metabolites. So this is what we do. And what we basically see then, that if you correlate the effect estimates that we see of the metabolites for Alzheimer's disease to the effect estimates to what we see on hippocampal volume, we see that really the correlation is the strongest, as you would expect for Alzheimer's disease. That is depicted here on the right. That is a correlation of about minus 0.65. And of course, it's a negative, as we would expect, because a smaller hippocampus gives you a higher risk of Alzheimer's disease. For vascular dementia, the association is also significant, marginally significant, but as you can see, the correlation is much lower. So if we look at total brain volume, then we see very comparable findings for Alzheimer's and vascular dementia. So both are very strongly associated, from 0.52, minus 0.52 to minus 6.1 in Alzheimer, and very significant, suggesting that we really can replicate our findings using this setting. But what you can also see is that, of course, we have findings that are really overlapping between the two. These are depicted in as black dots, but we also have findings which are significant only for dementia. These are the red dots in the figure, or significant only for total brain volume, and these are the blue dots. So basically, this enriches not only this doesn't only give us an independent replication, but it also enriches our findings, that we also have findings in there which are significantly associated to hippocampal volume or total brain volume, but are not significant yet to dementia. So what we do not find is that I had anticipated that there is a strong association between vascular dementia and the metabolites and white matter hyperintensities and the metabolites. There is a problem with that analysis, because remember in the start of the presentation I mentioned we are rigorously adjusting for all vascular medication that a person uses. If you do that, you may over adjust through the vascular medication also for vascular risk factors. Many people with a high risk of white matter hyperintensities are, for instance, people are treated who have hypertension, and many of these with hypertension are treated with antihypertensives, and we are adjusting for that, and that may explain why we don't see a lot of hits popping up in the white matter pathology. What was a bit of a surprise, though, was that we do see a correlation for Alzheimer's disease and the effect and the metabolites that are associated also with white matter hyperintensities. And that's a bit puzzling, but it may also partly be explained by the fact that white matter hyperintensities may also perhaps pick up some amyloid pathology, or that we are dealing with a different mechanism that we haven't discovered yet. So what is ongoing is, can we use these metabolites to predict who is an Alzheimer case and who is a vascular dementia patient, and use that in the set of UKB participants with dementia that are not classified to predict, is these patients more likely Alzheimer or vascular dementia? So that brings me to the next part of my presentation, and that is, what were the novel findings which were not known before? Now, if you compare our findings with a study published by Tinkinen et al., that included the Rotterdam study, and included in that as such, we see there's two novel findings. One is the findings of the metabolites that are including the metabolites of the ketone bodies, the TCA-related metabolites, citrate itself and glucose, and the branched chain amino acids were already known, but the cluster of ketones are definitely new. And what is new, a cluster of small HDL cholesterols, which are very strongly FDR significant in the UK Biobank, but weren't seen in our previous analysis. Now, the TCA set is really an interesting set because it links so beautifully to the animal-based studies, aging models of animals that show this energy effect in these models over age. So what we did next is integrate these data, what we know of the genetic and epidemiological risk factors. And what we first did was what everybody does nowadays in epidemiology and genetics is do a Mendelian randomization analysis, studying whether there's evidence that the metabolites are really a causal risk factor of the disease, and that would predict that the genes involved in the metabolites are explaining the dementia, or whether we are more dealing with a genetic process that is driven by the disease, and that would predict that the genes involved dementia predict the metabolite levels. So we conducted this study together with the Bristol group using the data of the Bristol group in the UK Biobank. And if you take the first hypothesis that the metabolite is a primary risk factor, we only see some evidence for that of the small HDL-CE. If you look at the other side, so on the ketone body related and the TCA related metabolites, we find significant evidence that rather the genes involved in dementia explain the ketone levels. So how to interpret that? You can interpret that in classically, I think 5 years ago, everybody would say this is a consequence of the disease. We're getting more cautious now. I think we are more inclined to study now also whether this is an intermediate step between the genes of determining dementia and the expression of disease. So what you can also see that we depict in here, and I think that is not very readable from your end now, is that the upper level are the significant levels for the Mendelian randomization experiment as such. But the intermediate is indicating whether there is significant evidence for heterogeneity. And you can see that in all cases, almost in the lowest row, but also in for SHDL, there is evidence that there is heterogeneity between genes. So to get a feel from that, we depicted here the association of the metabolites to dementia, but also its association to the genetic risk score that adds up the effects of all dementia. the role of APOE4 in the metabolites, APOE2 and the genetic risk score, but then cutting out the APOE effect. So more or less this picture, I think for those of you working a little bit in Mendelian randomization gives a good impression why the Mendelian randomization is so messy. Because if we look at APOE itself, then we see that a number of metabolites show an effect consistent what we expect based to see in dementia, in that APOE4 increases the risk of dementia and E2 decreases the risk. And that would predict, if you assume that this is somewhere metabolites are in between the genetic effect and the disease effect, that you expect that APOE4, and if we go to beta hydroxybutyrate, has a similar effect on the metabolite as seen with dementia, but APOE2, as it predicts, has an opposite effect. So we do see this is quite compatible with the ketone bodies and also with the branched chain amino acid. We see as an expected association also with some of the small HDLs and of the larger VLDLs percentage that popped up as significant. However, in all other cases, it's either the case that APOE4 and APOE2 has a similar effect. That was easy to discover what is ongoing there, because if you look at the instances that APOE4 has the same effect as APOE2, it always involves triglycerides. So it involves total triglycerides, the triglyceride content of VLDL, also of XLVLDL, SVLDL, it always has to do with the amount of triglycerides, and that is very much in the same direction as driven by APOE2 and APOE4. But there's also instances that we find the opposite effect, and that puzzled us for a long time, but it took us not long to realize that if you compare in those instances, and if you look at the genes other than APOE, actually the genes other than APOE gives you a better picture than APOE itself. So the pattern of association, if you just compare the colors, are always in the same direction for this these genes without APOE adding up their effect. So what do you find? So it's quite amazing that if you look at a picture now emerging, is that what we've done here is plot on the x-axis all the genes that we have now identified in the EADB as being consistently replicatable associated with Alzheimer's disease. So that are over 80 variants. And on the y-axis, we just depict here all the metabolites that we found significant for dementia. And we start clustering the findings. You see a pattern emerging that the association between the VLDLs for the different genes is far from consistent. So there is a group of genes on the right-hand side, which we usually call the cathepsin 8 group, which shows clearly a positive association with the XLVLDLs. And there's a group on the left-hand side, which we usually refer to as the ABCA team, which has an inverse association. What we also see, and that's the good news, it's not so difficult for the TCA cycle related metabolites. There are some instances of inconsistency, but for these metabolites, there is quite a consistent association that is mostly compatible also with the APOE effect, increasing effect of APOE4 and a decreasing effect of APOE2. So what happens if you do the same clustering then for the environmental risk factors? Well, it's quite remarkable that you again see a cluster emerging of the TCA cycle, and we were very amazed, but pleasantly surprised, and we kept our fingers crossed, but it worked. And what we see developing there, that if you look at the people with dementia, they all nicely cluster together, the Alzheimer's, vascular dementia, and the Alzheimer's disease, if you consider these metabolites at least. And this cluster is just characterized by low levels of branched-chain amino acids, so this includes valine and leucine also, low omega-3 fatty acid levels, and high levels of glucose, citrate, acetone, beta-hydroxybutyrate, acetate, and VLDL-FC. So that is quite amazing that we find the same association, but what we also see in this picture, that what doesn't very well cluster with Alzheimer's and vascular dementia is all these cardiometabolic risk factors at middle age that are associated with the disease. And what we also see in this cluster, that if you take BMI, and as well as overweight, as well as obesity, so overweight, you have a BMI between 25 and 30, overweight over 30, these outcomes are associated inversely with beta-hydroxybutyrate. So that matches actually beautifully with our finding that if you are thinking about our Alzheimer patients, by definition, the follow-up period that we have in the UK Biobank is not more than 10 years. So all these patients have been cardiometabolically in the states of a 10-year period before the onset of the disease. And we see here that that the lower weight that we observe may well, very well be explained by the fact that these patients have increased their TCA cycle to produce energy for the brain. So how does this pan out if we go back to the TCA cycle? So TCA cycle, we have a low input in there of the branched-chain amino acid in the 10-year period before the disease onset. We are pretty low on fatty acid if we look at the omega-3, and we are high on glucose. And that is at first sight confusing. However, if you start realizing that, of course, a problem in patients with Alzheimer's disease is just the availability of glucose in the brain, despite of high glucose levels. So despite the fact that glucose levels are high in the blood, there is a shortage of glucose in the brain, and that may be very well related to problems with the blood-brain barrier, letting the glucose through, or the availability in the energy generation. So how does the VLDL fit in? Well, the VLDL, their mission in life is dragging triglyceride from one place to another, and triglyceride metabolism is very much involved in the fatty acid metabolism. So having done this, we first ask ourselves the question, well, we have a finding, but beta-hydroxybutyrate increases with age. And our first question was, is this what we expect? Because despite all the wonderful diets that are around focusing on increasing your ketone bodies by restricting your carbohydrates, we could really not find any literature that showed how beta-hydroxybutyrate as one of the key factors that we found explaining this link between obesity and weight. And in the 10 years before the disease onset, we couldn't find literature on that. And we went to one of the experts, Newman in San Diego, who was a gerontologist, a geriatrics, working in geriatrics also. And we asked, well, how can we not find that? And he bluntly said, well, there's not a lot of data around that. So the UKB is really giving us the first picture that beta-hydroxybutyrate really increases with age. But we also find that there's this very significant difference between APOE4 carriers, here depicted in blue, and APOE3-free carriers, having the highest beta-hydroxybutyrate levels in the E4, and the lowest levels are found in the E2. So that gave us a hypothesis. I'm not so sure whether I should make this go away. What is happening? So one of the hypotheses we want to raise is that in APOE4, there's a problem with glucose. It doesn't pass the blood-brain barrier. And there's a relative shortage of glucose in the brain. Therefore, the brain needs alternative fuel. That's beta-hydroxybutyrate. You switch that on. And what is probably the case, of course, there's an active signaling between the brain and the liver, is that the liver has to produce more beta-hydroxybutyrate to compensate for the relative shortage of energy. So another thing we started analyzing, and this is also something that panned out beautifully, is, well, what happens to these other factors in that are associated to dementia and are part of the TCA cycle over age. And we were quite pleasantly surprised to see that if you look at the total branched chain amino acids, we see that they also increase with age. And what we also see that all of a sudden after the age of 50, we see these levels declining, particularly in the APOE4, but also in the APOE3-free carriers. So the genotype that is relatively protecting against Alzheimer's disease stays the highest in these levels. So we see some evidence for this for APOE4, also for omega-3, the fatty acids that we also found in the cluster in the epidemiological analysis. And we do see, of course, a very strong effect on BMI. We're not the first to report this because this has been reported by San Francisco group who is really trying to model this, but there definitely is, when adjusting for most risk factors, also a decrease, a leveling of your BMI after age 50. So what does we explain? So our hypothesis is that, that we are dealing with a risk factor in the case of beta-hydroxybutyrate that may mediate APOE, the effect of APOE on dementia. The effect is relatively small for APOE4. The mediating effect is not more than 1%. However, if you look at APOE2, you find more metabolites are potentially mediating the association. And that is quite a larger number that we had to catch into a principal component analysis because all of these are very much associated. And if we then estimate how much of the effect of APOE2 protection on dementia may be explained by APOE2, we come to a percentage around 7% if we do a formal mediation analysis. So that briefly brings me to the last part, and that is based on our cellular modeling. And we are part, our group is part of the ADAPTED Consortium. That is a consortium funded by IMI, European Union, that in which academic groups together with industry is trying to solve one of the major problems that is pestering us. How does Alzheimer's disease relate to apolipoprotein E? So a lot of work has been going on both on the human as well as the cellular side, but one of the key aims of this consortium was to construct iPSC-based cells of the brain, and that involved the neurons, the astrocytes, the microglia, and also the macrophages as one of the communicator between the brain and the blood. So we managed to get, the plan was to get six different cell lines using all the different genotypes as a starting point. There was quite some failure in editing of these cells because we aimed to have these cell lines completely isogenic. So only the two, three and four allele in homozygosity forms were supposed to be the difference between the cell lines that, and the, for that we used a lot of editing. A lot of didn't work, and actually one of the two lines, we think there is an editing error in there also. that may explain why this cell line doesn't always behave exactly the same as the other cell line, UKB or Bayonis. And what we basically also think that there is a lot of noise also that just by sheer potluck, or we selected one donor of an African background and one donor of a European background. And as we all are realizing now in the field of genetics, the haplotype around these ApoE genes in Africans and Europeans is very different. So on the one hand, an interesting experiment, on the other hand, also a kind of a noisy experiment. So the cell lines are published, they are available. You can get them from eBIS for the Oxford site, and they're also characterized in depth by the IMI consortium, transcriptomics, lipidomics, proteomics, and have all been conducted. We wanted this full matrix to be filled, but we didn't make this in time for the end of the consortium. And this is what we have so far. So we've done a lot of comparisons between the ApoE 22 and 44, but what is quite unique in this set is that we also have a knockout, and the knockout is quite useful because it gives you quite a nice impression what happens, what is the functional effect of ApoE. And we have actually analyzed these data mostly in Oxford. Nadia van Mien has done this the past years. And what we basically see that if we plot here what we see in microglia, astrocytes, the macrophages and the neurons, is that do we see evidence for the TCA popping up? Well, we do see the lipids popping up. That is what we had expected in both the macrophages, the astrocytes, and the microglia. And what we further see that if we go to the functions of these different cell types, and this is the microglia, we do see, it's not the most significant, ignore the ones here, but on the end of the Bayoni cell line, we see ATP clearly popping up. We see ATL as a major factor popping up in the other workstream. But I'm not very convinced here that there isn't a lot of replication between the two. And therefore, I don't think this is the strongest findings. However, if you go to more in-depth applications in the reactome pathway, again, we see the HDL popping up in workstream 4, but also we see the TCA cycle finally popping up here in both cell lines. So this is clearly replicated, clustering along with the mitochondrial effects that you also expect for these cell lines. So we see this specifically in the astrocyte, and that is, I think, the most interesting cell type for the TCA cycle, because if you look at the astrocyte, it's the ketogenic cell in the brain that is really playing a key role in generating and passing on the ketone bodies to the neurons. So summing up, what do we find? We find two clusters, one of small ACL metabolites associated vascular dementia, and one of the ketone bodies that are primarily associated to Alzheimer's disease, but also there's some evidence for vascular dementia, albeit not significant. If we look at our Mendelian randomization, the levels of beta-hydroxybutyrate and also the branched-chain amino acids seem to be changed as in the disease process, linking the genes involved in Alzheimer's disease to the disease. The iPSC knockout model really supports that ApoE is in fact involved in the TCI cycle in the astrocyte, which is the ketogenic cell in the brain. And what we actually find that the high levels of beta-hydroxybutyrate in the blood in combination with high glucose levels really flag the compensation of the body due to the reduced availability of glucose in the brain. So we see some mediation, ApoE2 protective effect may be partly mediated to that, explaining about 8%. That's not overwhelming, but we have to start somewhere in this complex disease. And last but not least, I think these changes that we see in the TCA may explain why we see this weight loss of the patients 10 years before the disease onset, a period where you don't expect a patient to lose weight because of forgetting to eat. So I have to disclose and to thank Nightingales. We had pre-access to this data. We've been analyzing these data already before they came available upon their request. And for that, we received some funding of the National Institute of Aging. And a big thank you for that, for both of that. And of course, a big thanks also to the people who did the work. I think June Liu did a really heavy weightlifting on analyzing all the data that are there on the Nightingale setting for the dementia. Najaf Amin has been analyzing the iPSC data, but also in on the fly analyzed the Nightingale's data in relation to depression, which is also very interesting findings. And a big thank you to also Aleo Nevado. He is not yet on the slide yet. I just addressed him this morning that he should get on Ordiero's slide. What I haven't showed is that we did a lot of machine learning also in the background. So far, that hasn't yet given us findings that are overruling our classical statistical analysis. But however, we do have hope that the machine learning will help us to distinguish Alzheimer patients and vascular dementia patients using these metabolites. And we still keep our fingers crossed on that, as that may be one of the major findings on machine learning. Also a big thanks to Rima Kadugaduk. I think she has been the driving force also getting us some funding from the NIH to do this has been really setting up a team on her side that includes a lot of chemists that help us interpret the data and dealing with the data. So that's also concerning a group of Helmholtz in Munich, Indiana University, and Cornell. And with that, I would like to thank you for your attention and hear if you have any questions.
Great, thank you so much, Cornelia, for kickstarting our seminar series. And please do use the chat to ask questions, which Cornelia and I can monitor. And while people are thinking of what they'd like to put in there, we've got one. Yeah, Kevin Talbot is asking, isn't there a problem with using the term disease onset as the point of diagnosis of clinical dementia?
Disease onset in the term of that the disease is progressing earlier, I guess, right?
So I think Kevin means, you know, the disease onset is different from the point of diagnosis.
Definitely. So what we've been working on is in the UK Biobank, we assume that most patients, we excluded everyone with a prevalent dementia. That doesn't exclude that there may be patients in there that are already way on their way. So the first patient with a new diagnosis emerged about 2 years after. That means that there are subclinical patients in there. So the only important factor that why we use this diagnosis is that that gives us this window of the people who converse to really dementia. But of course, in all analysis, we use the hippocampal volume and the endophenotypes, but also some of the cognition data that are usable. So that's fluid intelligence that we have on most patients and reaction time. We use that as endophenotypes to capture these early phases of the disease also. So we very much see this as a complete continuum, and this is why we use it also as a replication.
And
I hope that answers the question.
I think so. Let me just ask you one myself then. The metabolic associations with dementia. I mean, you raised this issue about, is it chicken or egg? And so what do you think the answer is? Is it chicken or egg?
Well, we're starting to change our feelings about it. So I think that if you look at the associations to the early endocrine phenotypes, so if you look at hippocampal volume, brain volume, you do see effects that are occurring very much early. So yeah, I don't think that the associations that we are finding are explained, for instance, by the fact that patients with dementia are forgetting to eat. I thought that already unlikely in the Million Women study. 10 years before the onset of the disease, you still know that your coat goes on where your coat should go. You don't put your socks on your head. I think it's unlikely that you forget to eat. The same holds for the endocrine phenotype. So I don't think it's not a consequence of the dementia as such. I do think, and that is why we did the formal mediation analysis, I do think these are linkers somehow between the genetic effects and the environmental risk factors and the disease onset. Mm-hmm. And as such, you're talking, whether you call it biomarkers or intermediate steps, I think for the TCA cycle, I'm more inclined to think that we have a biological mechanism here that is just burning up your body in order to get ketone bodies to get the brain going. And somehow that fails and somehow you develop then dementia.
Okay, and a related question, Kevin's following on here, is how does exercise relate? Are there modifiable factors here? And could exercise also affect your metabolism, I wonder?
There's a lot, and also nutrition and exercise are very much associated to these metabolites. We did not make the formal plot yet, but we know, for instance, that DHA relates to exercise, but that also relates very much to fish consumption. So that is clearly a modifier. How to pen that out in a translational setting, whether you should, for instance, beta-hydroxybutyrate is already trialed as for dementia prevention. You see, strangely enough, that it doesn't work that well if you take cognitive function as an outcome in APOE4 carriers. And it puzzled us enormously, but that may also be that these APOE4 carriers are in that state already that they can't deal with anything that comes from outside the brain inside there. So there's a lot of questions how to interpret that, but I think definitely we see a lot of environmental risk factors modifying your metabolites, and that's what we expect, as well as the genes itself.
Okay. Just going to encourage other people to ask questions. Paul White, can you comment on high ketone diet as a modifier, Cornelia?
It's fantastic, because if you're looking for these ketone diet, they are really dominating the literature on the whole TCA cycle now. So it's definitely, I just mentioned it's trialed, it's in trials already. So people are trying to improve the cognition by increasing ketone levels, and particularly beta-hydroxybutyrate is very central to that. I think that mentioning that, why doesn't the APOE4 respond anymore? The question is, again, shouldn't we start with those interventions earlier and find also a better readout how to monitor that? So up until now in the trials, the outcome has always been cognition. What you start thinking of looking at these data is definitely also you start looking at hippocampal volume, perhaps as an outcome to be measured, either in a ongoing trial still, because these data must be available, or also in longitudinal follow-up studies, like the epidemiological studies, like the Rotterdam study, the Million Women study, and the Framingham Heart study.
Mm-hmm. So we've got another couple of questions here from Lei, and they ask, could you please talk a bit more about the machine learning you've done, and how will machine learning be useful in dementia research in general?
We did a lot of machine learning, but we learned also a lot of the troubles with it, I think. So I think Aleo Nevado is really involved in this, both in the group of Nightingales, but we also have a small group that is aiming to explore this further. We did various approaches, so neural networks, but also random forest, elastic nets. And what we came up to that if the approach I presented today is really the good old same approach that I used in GWAS, and that is just analyze the metabolites one by one and then cluster them later. So that worked pretty well, and that worked also pretty well and insightful. What we experienced as the major problem with machine learning is that it's very much related to the platform, is that we have very dense data, for instance, on the VLDLs. So there's a huge number of VLDLs, HDLs, LDLs, and then large, small, extra large forms measured. And they all tend to cluster together. And the problem we are experiencing actually is that because of this high density clustering of these metabolites, often the machine learning approaches get very confused, and they start saying, okay, it must be the VLDL, or it must be. And that is a bit of the problem we have encountered. In order to disentangle it, and we haven't given up hope yet, so we are still, actually, as of today, we are still setting up a new experiment in, is to try really a neural network, but use different layers and use also a little bit of a supervised clustering in there in order to disentangle with the metabolites who is a vascular dementia, who is an Alzheimer dementia, and see whether we can really disentangle the two of them using machine learning. But I think the trials and tribulations are not related to the lack of knowledge. I think we have a top team in psychiatry working on it. But the trials and tribulations is that these data are so correlated, and that is not what machine learning is happy with.
Dominic Simpson asks, have any of these metabolic changes been measured in mice with different ApoE genotypes?
I've most is it on ApoE4 aging mouse. I don't know why that is. I think there was maybe a couple of studies on ApoE2, but most of the research has focused on ApoE4. I think also with the reason that is a clear aging effect on there. Of course, ApoE2 also doesn't only protect from dementia, but also from dying early, so it predicts longevity. There is not a lot of data on ApoE2. I think in our adapted consortium, we do have some data on ApoE2 and aging mouse in APFI, but it's very scattered. But what is, if you're interested in a mouse, what is very interesting is that this leveling of ketones, of course, if that happens after 50, any epidemiologist thinks this must be menopause, right? And one of the nicest experiments that I saw that only ended up in plus one as a finding is that people looked at female mouse, and they found that after their age of reproduction had gone, they also found in female mice who are ApoE4 that their beta hydroxybutyrate went down, which is actually an amazing finding that fits very well what we see in the human. So there's definitely room for an ApoE2 mouse to be studied, but it will will not be an easy phenotype, I'm afraid.
Yeah. Any more questions? While people are thinking, maybe one more for you from me, Cornelia, which is, of course, the UK Biobank is great in terms of the size and scale, but one of the problems is the quality of the diagnosis. So distinguishing between Alzheimer's disease and vascular dementia is a very tough call. And we know most people with Alzheimer's disease also have vascular changes in the brain. So maybe the curious findings you got between AD and VD, as it were, relate partly to the noise in terms of diagnosis.
Yeah, I think the findings of the hippocampal volume are okay, because you expect that it may be more Alzheimer than vascular dementia. I wasn't surprised that both associate to total brain volume. I'm very surprised with the white matter lesions. I would have thought that it would be much more vascular than I anticipated. But I think you're completely right. I think if you ask the people, these are based on hospital-based records, and well, you are the clinician, you know how these distinctions are often made. And I think they're definitely made also based on the cardiovascular risk profile. But talking to a couple of our colleagues which were involved is that most people will say, well, I don't see a lot of difference clinically between a lot of vascular dementia patients in the clinical picture of the dementia and the Alzheimer's patient. So I take your point completely. I think if people don't see that, we get the data will not be better in the UK Biobank. And there must be a lot of misclassification.
Okay, final question. So this one is actually from Evandro Fang from Oslo, who's attending. Can you comment on what specific AI methods you have used?
So we did neural networks. That was quite good in the setting. We used also ETNI data, of course, for replication. And that, Aleo can give a presentation on that, I think, or one of his students. Mm-hmm. On that, we used a random forest also. We used ElasticNet a lot. We did a lot of classification. So I think we quite always tried this, but we always used in parallel, and I would advise everybody to do that, also the classical statistics. So that gives you the simple, maybe not the most powerful, but associations as well as the machine learning, because I think doing them together helps you a lot understanding also the findings, and that is what we wanted. We didn't only want to predict, we also wanted to understand what we see.
Great. So I'm going to close here, Cornelia. Thank you so much for doing that. I know I didn't know anything about this stuff that you're showing today, so that's an eye-opener, and love to talk to you about it afterwards. But great. Thank you so much for doing that. And thank you all for attending our first seminar in the Dementia Research Oxford series.